Thank you. Thank you all. Also, welcome people on the live stream. Hello, Rafaella. Okay. Thank you for being here. So, who is afraid of Aria?
Not anymore.
Yeah. On the slide is Arya Stark from Game of Thrones. I'm Rian Rietveld. I'm a senior accessibility consultant at Level. That's a WordPress agency in Rotterdam, the Netherlands. And I also give workshops, I teach, and I do reviews. So everything accessibility related. Slides are on slideshare.net/Rian Rietveld. So if you want to look them up later. In this talk, I'm going to explain to you what is ARIA, the first rule of ARIA, and examples how to use ARIA. And therefore, I'm going to do a live demo of a screen reader, so wish me luck. I hope everything goes well. And after that, I will give you a list of good resources for your own study, if you want to learn more about how to use ARIA. So first of all, what is ARIA? The official abbreviation is WAI, ARIA. WAI stands for Web Accessibility Initiative. That's a working group from the W3C. And ARIA stands for Accessible Rich Internet Application Suite. So it's actually ARIAS, but whatever. This is the definition. ARIA defines a way to make web content and web applications more accessible to people with disabilities. So it helps people with disabilities understand a website better. It's all about feedback. What happens on a page? What does this mean? How can I interact? That is what ARIA is useful for. But the first rule of ARIA, don't use ARIA. That's very contradictory, but I will explain what I mean. Don't use ARIA to fix meaningless or incorrect HTML5. Don't build something and then afterwards think, oh, it had to be accessible, and then throw in a bunch of ARIA to make it work. That's not what ARIA is for. One great example is how we treat hamburger menus. Who does this? Div with an ID menu to hang the JavaScript on, menu and div. I think 50% of all the hamburgers are made like this. If you want this to make this accessible, you have to do a lot of work. Because if you use a keyboard, and you cannot use a mouse, you tap from focusable control to focusable control. And a div doesn't get keyboard focus. So you cannot access the menu. And if the menu is the only way to access the rest of the website, people who cannot use a mouse can only see the home page. That's very annoying. So what you do, you add tab index 0. Okay, then it actually gets keyboard focus, but the JavaScript isn't fired. You add a rose button. You add area pressed is false, and you toggle it to true. Then you make it actually work. But don't do this. Don't throw in a lot of area to fix meaningless incorrect HTML. This is wrong. Use a button. Then you get everything for free. Get keyboard focus, the JavaScript is fired, you get it all for free. This is right. Saves you also a lot of lines of code. Semantics gives you it all for free. So, learn HTML5 deeply. Before you learn ARIA, before you learn JavaScript, dig into HTML5, because that is what put to the browser. That's what interact with all the technology, now and also in the future. HTML5, meaningful code, is sustainable for the future. ARIA is all about feedback. what happens on a page? What does it mean? How can I interact? Okay. I will give you examples on how to use ARIA. The code is in CodePen, bit.li/wcno-aria, if you want to look at it later. I want to address a few ARIA properties. ARIA expanded, to tell if something is open or closed. ARIA live, to tell someone who cannot see what's happening on a page. The JavaScript method WPLE speak, that's built in into core, into WordPress core, so you can all use it. ARIA label and screen reader text class. ARIA labeled by and ARIA described by. It seems a lot, but I have time to demo it, so I will do that now. So the code pen, if you want to see the code. And after that, I will have some resources. So, So we'll start with ARIA expanded, and I'll show it to you. Mouse doesn't work. Is there a block for the mouse? Oh, yeah, it is. Okay, it's really slow. ARIA expanded. For example, you have an accordion, or you have a menu. Then you have a button, list of numbers. If you click the button, then a list of numbers opens. And if you click it again, it will close again. But if you are blind, you have no idea what's happening. So it can be told to you with ARIA expanded. So I will fire up the screen reader.
Voice over on Safari, ARIA expanded window, toolbar.
Can you hear this?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. You see on the dark line, there is where the screen reader is announcing stuff. So he is now on the toolbar. If I press tab, I go from focusable control to focusable control. In this case, that's the button. So I do tab.
List of numbers collapsed button.
It says list of items, numbers, that's what inside the text in the button. It says that's a button, and it also says collapsed. So someone who is blind is notified, okay, if I activate the button by, for example, enter or space, then something is showing after that. So I
list of numbers expanded button.
Now I know, okay, if I read further, there is extra information. If I don't want to do that,
list of numbers collapsed button.
Then I press the button again and I can read without the extra information. This is, for example, useful for a menu. Do I want to read the menu or not? Is the menu open or closed? So I will show you how the code works.
PHP storm, ARIA, tilde, voice over off.
Okay. This is how it works. You have a button and you have an ARIA expanded and set the default to false. And then you have a toggle, that's with the JavaScript, you toggle. The list below is hidden. You can use the HTML5 hidden or display none, whatever you like. Then it's very useful is the button is just above the stuff you're going to toggle. If you have a menu, the button to open the menu, it's very important that it's just above the menu you're going to toggle. Because then the screen reader can read from there to the menu or the thing you are toggling. This is clear. Other questions about this? Yeah, I will answer questions later. Okay. So I will show you again with the screen reader.
Voice over on Safari, ARIA expanded window, toolbar.
Okay.
Go back button. ARIA expanded web cop. Show fake. List of numbers collapsed button. List of numbers expanded button. Numbers. Bullet 1. Bullet 2. Bullet 3.
See?
Bullet 4.
Now you can read it. And the screen reader user knows, okay, there's extra information. That's area expanded.
Voice over off.
Okay. Next one. I'm toggling a bit between screens. Area life. Tell me what's changing. For example, you have a form and you want to do a submit without a page reload. And then you want to inform the user your changes have been saved successfully. If you cannot see, those changes are silent because there's no page reload. So what you can do is put the changes in an area live region. I will first show you how it works, and then I will show you the code. So, fire up the screen reader.
Voice over on Safari. Your name, edit text.
Now I forget focus on the input fields, and I do something.
M. T. Map. Submit button. Changes saved successfully.
Now this is the announced. I will show you.
Voice over off.
This is too small, is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Good.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. Okay. What you do, you put an area and div, for example, with an area live is polite in it. If you have an area live region, that must be present before the changes occur. We have area live with an ID and a class and whatever. The screen reader listens to an area live region, so the element that has an area live in it. If there are changes inside that div, then the screen reader will announce it. You have two different area lives. You have area live polite. Then the screen reader waits until you stop typing or interacting. And you have area live assertive that's in your face immediately, for example, for error warnings. So in this case, the area live is filled with the your changes have been saved successfully. This is very small too. This is a JavaScript. This is very rudimentary. You all can do that probably very well. But it gives you an alert to the text content, and it says change is saved successfully. That is injected into the div with the area live. So I will do it again, and I'll do a... Now I have to do a page reload. Okay, because if the area live is already filled with something and it's the same, nothing announces, so it only listens to changes.
Voice over on Safari, your name, edit text, M-A-T-T. Submit button, changes saved successfully.
That's because the area live region is filled with the changes saved successfully text, and it announces it. That's area live. So you can use your own JavaScript, but you can also use WP Alice Speak. And then we have a rock star here in the room.
Voice over off.
Called Sami. Who wrote excellent documentation about this on his website, Foxland. The original article on WordPress.org, an example on GitHub, how you can do that, and also a demo. So let's do the demo. Then I will try to do an inspect code. Can you see this, or is this too low, too small? Okay. If you have the JavaScript method WP Alice Speak implemented in your JavaScript, and when it's loaded, it adds two divs at the bottom of your page, just above the end body. And there's a div with an ID, and this is a div area live is polite. It adds also a div, area life is assertive. And you can choose when you call the JavaScript method if you want to fill the area life is polite or the area life is assertive. So this will be static in your page. So. And now I'll find the screen reader.
Voice over on Safari, WordPress speaks, testing. Kaorinka. Select city, pop-up button, main.
Select city. And then the results of the city you are selecting is changed dynamically. And then the
menu tick, Kaorinka, Kuopio. Select city, pop-up button, filtering contacts was successful.
What screen reader says is filtering content has been successful. So you announce to the screen reader something has changed. You don't have to announce everything that's changed. For example, if you have search results, you don't have to announce all the search results. If you have a search and that adds dynamically the results below, you can say, for example, new search results have been found, or there are 15 search results, or there are no search results. And the results can be, or something like, we have results, you can read them below, something like that. Don't announce everything, but that's very annoying.
Voice over off.
So, thank you, Sami.
Thank you, Sami. I have a question.
Yeah.
Is there any localization for...
You can localize area. It's just text. So you can localize it. There are in the accessibility handbook on makewordpress.org are examples on how you can localize area, and also localize how you can localize the WP Ali speak. And it's just text. Mm-hmm. So you can do it in the text of people who read the website. Yeah. No problem. Right. Next one. Other questions about WP Ali speak? No? Okay. Let's go to the next one. Babel. If you have a link for the example, it's called edit. People who are blind can call a list of links to quickly navigate and understand the page. And if all the links are called edit or read more or download, it's for them very difficult to distinguish which link does what. So you can add area label to a link. You can add it to a button, to a focusable element. In this case, first I'll read it, I'll explain it, and then you can listen to it. First case, no area label, it just will say edit. The second, I have an area label, edit my awesome post to the edit. And then it will announce, edit my awesome post. The last one is, I have an area label that says something completely different as here inside. So you have to beware, area label on links overrules the complete link text. And the other one I will explain later. Okay.
Voice over on Safari, area label, window, tool, link, edit.
Link. It tells it's link, and the link text is edit. Now we put an area label on the link text with a different text.
Link, edit my awesome post.
This is very convenient if your graphic designer says, okay, this has to be so small button on and it must only say load more. Then you have now the power to actually have other text in that. For both load more, about, and then more information. It's just giving a different text to a screen reader user with more information, but then the visual presentation stays nice and small. That's all graphic designers lack. But beware, you can put text in it that's totally crap. For example,
link, edit my awesome post.
And then you're deleting it. So don't do this. Okay. Good.
Voice over off.
And I will show you the text. Hopla. Enlarge it a bit. So the first one was just a normal link. href, your URL edit. it's how we do links. And then, it's href URL and an area label, and then you put the text in it. And if you use PHP, you can use whatever a localization you want in this. And then edit, and this is the really link text you see. So this will announce, edit my awesome post. And then the last one, it says delete, but it will announce edit my awesome post. But then, there's another way to do. You can use the screen reader text class. Which one you use depends on the case, on the functionality. But you can have a screen reader text class that also hides from screen, but it will be announced by a screen reader. I will show you how that looks somewhere in the CSS. This is screen reader text class. It says border null 0 and clip, and clip path, this is for backwards compatibility. Height is 0, because if you have height is one pixel, because if you have one height is 0, screen reader will not announce it. Margin minus 1 pixel, overflow hidden, padding 0, position absolute, and that screws up a bit. And then width is 1 pixel, and a word wrap is normal. The last one is necessary for Safari, because if you have a space that is 1 pixel wide, then Safari will read the word letter by letter. So if you have word wrap is normal, then it will read as whole words. So, and what does that do? So you have here, edit, and then you have a span my awesome post. The advantage of this is that this is more robust, because not every screen reader knows ARIA yet. Older screen readers don't know ARIA. Newer screen readers, modern software does. So I think ARIA is safe to use, but sometimes for very old screen readers, ARIA is not supported. And then you have one advantage of this, you have actually text inside your link. Google doesn't index ARIA yet. So if for SEO, it's maybe the screen reader text better, if you value the text that's inside for your SEO ranking. So, and but there's a snag. If you use Safari, VoiceOver,
VoiceOver on Safari, ARIA label.
Okay, link. Edit.
Edit.
Edit my link. Awesome post.
Edit my awesome post. Link. Edit my awesome post.
And then?
Link. My awesome post. Edit.
Then it switches around. That's because of the position absolute. So ARIA is safer to announce, but maybe more robust for old screen readers and browsers. Choose yourself what you like best. It's not always...
VoiceOver off.
Okay, now, are there questions about this? Yeah.
Just a quick question. Can you confirm, is it in the guidelines now that if you use ARIA label or whatever method you use, that you need to, the beginning of the link needs to be the same. So if you have like edit, and edit my awesome post.
Yeah.
And then the visual link is edit. That's okay. But if I had it's not good. You know, my awesome post edit wouldn't be good English. But if I'd written that, that would also be a violation of the guidelines.
It's like the edit text is totally, the text inside the link is totally different than the area label text, if that's
but
a violation.
The beginning,
I don't know, Sami?
I think it's
that a violation? That it has to be the same, the beginning? I have never heard that.
I think it's in 2.1.
Yeah, in 2.1, yeah, it's a kind of a new rule that it should be the same because of the different kind of devices might actually see the edit word inside a link.
And I think it was because of, for speech, like speech.
Yeah. Oh, for Dragon, like for targeting a button like or a link, that it has to be the first word has to be the same, otherwise the Dragon cannot target it.
Exactly. I say
okay, that makes sense. Yeah, that you have the first word must be the same. So some assistive technology look for words in buttons and links, so they can target it better. Okay, yeah, that's a good one. Thank you. Yeah, yeah. So Yoaster here? I don't know. I'm not an SEO expert, so I don't know that answer. Yeah. Okay. I will go further with area label, and there's another use for that. You can overwrite content for a link or a button, but you can add content to landmarks. This is a very rudimentary page. Like, I'm really a graphic designer, as you can see. You have here a menu, and you have, this is the header, and you have a menu in the header. This is your main, yada, yada, yada. And this is your footer, and you have also a menu in the footer. Screen reader users can navigate by landmarks. I will show you.
Voice over on Safari, area label on landmarks, window, toolbar.
They can call the web router.
Window spots menu, links menu.
In the web router, you have links. All the links on
headings
the page.
Headings menu.
All the headings on the page.
Landmarks menu.
And landmarks. 3 minutes. Hallelujah. Okay, I will just question time. We'll include the question time. Yeah. Okay. You have a banner. That's the heading. And you have a main menu, navigation. And this main menu is an area label. Then you have the main content information, that's the footer. And you have a content links navigation. That's also an area label.
Toolbar, PHP editor for area label. Voice over off.
Show you. So you have two navigations, nav. And you want to give you area main menu, and the other nav, you give the navigation area label content links. So then you can distinguish different kind of navigations from each other. This gives extra information to screen reader user of what's happening on the page, how they can quickly navigate. Then the last one, area described by and area labeled by. This is very useful in forms. As you know, you can tab from focusable element to focusable element. And especially in forms, blind users or users with use keyboard only, they tab in a form from input element to select from all the form elements. But then, they miss information. For example, if you have information about how to fill out the form. Here you have a name, and below that is, please give your first and last name. But if you tap, you only hear name. So what you can do is use area labeled by, that replaces the label text. And you can have area described by, that adds content to another element, for example here, in the input field. So I will fire the screen reader and then you can hear it. Ta-da, 20.
Voice over on set. What?
Okay.
Please give your
what?
First
okay, here.
Name, edit text.
Name, edit text. That's all you hear. And because you are in form mode, you just tap from focusable element, you completely miss this as screen reader user. So then I use area labeled by on the label.
Please give your first and last name, edit text.
So it reads, please give your first and last name, and then edit text. So it replaces the name with please give your first and last name. And then the last one.
Name, edit text. Please give your first and last name.
That was intense.
He's a bit slow. And to be honest, screenreader users have this like 2,000 times faster. So it waits a bit, and then I have to screenreader very, very slow. So it announces the name, and then the extra information when you focus the input field. So these are two ways to give this extra information to people who fill out the form and only tap through it, otherwise they miss the information.
Voice over off.
Okay. And this is how it works. First is without nothing. This label, input, and we all know an input field needs a label. Yeah? You do that, everyone? Yeah? Okay. And then, a label. And it has an area labeled by, and this is the ID from the paragraph with this ID. So this is coupled to each other. So it replaces completely the name with this text. And the last one, you have a label and an input field, and an input field has an area described by, and then it adds to the content. So the input field label is announced, and then with the input field, when it gets focused, please give your first and last name. So, okay. More time is gone. So, this is area. Not to fix crappy HTML, but to give extra information for people who cannot see the screen. Resources. These are the specs. WAI Area Authority Practices. They used to be very hard to read, and they are rewriting them into something really good to read. So don't be alarmed, don't be afraid of the specs. At makewordpress.org/accessibility, we have a handbook. And there is a lot of information about ARIA and links to other good resources. Thanks to Sami. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Then, Hayden Pickering wrote a book called Inclusive Components, and Hayden does excellent research. He uses modern HTML5, CSS3, the latest techniques, and he does a lot of research with JavaScript on how to make it work for everyone. Inclusive components, it doesn't cost much. There's also a website attached to it with a lot of example code. I really would recommend you buying that book because it's excellent. It's an ebook, so you can just download it. I think it's $20 or something, it's not much. Then the DQ University has a free online widget code library for using ARIA and all kinds of different components you may need for your work. So there is a lot of good example code. If you want to study more, Mike Gifford has he's the accessibility guy of Drupal. He has a GitHub repository with all kinds of different courses, online, offline, paid, free. Just take your pick if you want to really study further. I want to finish with a quote. Make it work before you make it nice. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Rian. We still have time for questions, but before Teemu fires the first one, I just want to notice one important thing about WPP AliSpeak. It's already in as an NPM package, has been a long time already, and you should check all the WordPress packages now from the NPM, because with the Gutenberg, they have been publishing lots of other cool stuff in there also. In this case, the AliSpeak is written by Vanilla.js, you definitely want to import only that part of the JS into your existing project. The reason is that you probably don't want to use jQuery library in your sites anymore, so use the NPM package version. I have the in the demo site the example of that, but it's just basically imported in the package and just use it. So now for the questions. Teemu was the first one, at least I saw.
Hi.
Can you hear me now? Okay. Can you give me a 1 minute tutorial how to use the voiceover on
the
Mac?
Okay. The voiceover is on the Mac, it's built in. Command F5 it fires, Command F5 it stops. That's the manual. No, it's well, Command F5 it fires and it asks you, do you want to have a tutorial? And there's a short tutorial with it. So I just spent an afternoon playing with it, and it's really simple screen reader. Blind people use professional stuff like NVDA. If you have a if you don't have a Mac but a Windows machine, NVDA is free. It's open source project. That's a more advanced screen reader. Takes more work to learn, but if you can master that, you're really good.
Yeah, it just takes a while to kind of get the hang of the keyboard shortcodes. But for example, WebAEM, I think, had pretty good tutorial on the basics of the how it, how those all, how do you get to set up the rotor, for example, that Rian showed. And how
Duke University has also cheat sheets. You can download as PDF with all the shortcodes for JAWS. JAWS is a paid paid screen reader, and that's really expensive. But for NVDA and for VoiceOver too, this DQ Lab, as you just Google DQ shortcode screen reader VoiceOver or something, I think you will get it.
For for basic testing, you basically want to have NVDA also, not just the VoiceOver, and because VoiceOver even isn't that used with the actual users.
Now I would disagree. I know a lot of people who are...
Well, people use it, but if you check the studies...
It's excellent to test with, because it's easy to learn. So if you're a developer and you have a Mac, it's really good to have an insight on how it works. Yeah.
So when you start VoiceOver, is a learning thing for Mac itself? There's like this pages where you go through and learn stuff?
Yeah, it's in there.
Yeah, it's like a tutorial. Yeah, you have a tutorial built in, so you can choose it. The first time you get such a pop-up window and you want to start VoiceOver or do the tutorial. Yeah.
Maybe about 10 basic commands. Yeah,
Daniel.
A good start for the basic testing. Daniel, do we have a microphone or somewhere? Ah, oh, sorry, I didn't see you.
Hello, hi, I'm Alta. So, I have been used to, I'm from a language area which is like, you know, 300,000 people. We've had speech synthesizers being done that, you know, only work on Windows.
Yeah.
Sometimes they work on Android, and sometimes people stick with these speech synthesizers for, you know, 15 years or whatever.
Yeah.
What is the current status of, do you know the current status of that in general, like with smaller language areas, or in general that users of screen readers tend to stick with legacy solutions for, let's say, even decades?
I think the basic functionality must work without ARIA to actually for older. In the Netherlands, they get every 4 year money to get a new screen reader. So in the worst case scenario, people are working with 4-year-old computers and screen readers. So you have to have a fallback, I think. Maybe that's the screen reader text class. It's very useful for that. You don't need to... it's for extra information, for explaining stuff on how things work. And I think if you have really main functionality that depends on ARIA, that's dangerous, I think. But... Oh, old assistive technology is like hell. It's just like, and you also have like all the browsers they use, and then an old computer. It's like we always say hell is other browsers, but if you work for accessibility, you have also all the older assistive technology.
Yeah, but
so
this really makes me feel like I'm having to support Internet Explorer 5.5 on the Mac. I can
Yeah, but on other hand, if you never go without a new development and not the new stuff, you stick like an old code. I think you can also just use CSS3, and a lot of browsers from people maybe don't still support that. So, and we all use CSS3. I think it's the same with ARIA. You just go with the new developments. Otherwise, you just stick in static HTML. So, yeah. But I, yeah, you have a valid point, but I also think you don't have to stick in old code. Yeah.
Hi. Actually, just a quick comment to that is that I think if as long as you're like building your site so that they're not like totally broken in whatever browser, then you're kind of pretty safe.
Burn HTML5 deeply.
Yeah, but yeah. I was just a comment on screen readers that in like at least if you've got like a recent Windows 10. Installation, it's got Narrator built in, which at least, I don't know how good it is.
I did some testing with Narrator. It's very basic. Yeah. Very, very basic.
But it's at least, but from like a developer's point of view, at least it's very easy to test with it. So at least,
yeah,
so you just
sort of...
Yeah,
but it does almost nothing.
I've heard it's got better, like,
Yeah?
Very,
okay,
pretty,
maybe
pretty
in
fast,
time
but,
it grows?
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's built in the Edge, or it works with Edge, the new Windows 10 Narrator. Yeah. Another one. Okay, I'm here all evening and tomorrow morning, so.
Yep. I think we need to go for the closing remarks soon. So thanks again, Rian,
okay,
for the
welcome.
Great talk.
Okay, I have one thing to say before you run. We have accessibility cards with tips for how to develop, design, and to write content accessible, the do's and don'ts. If you want those, these are 7 cards, come here and you'll get, and the first one, first go, yeah.